How was your summer, delinquent?
Painful.
Hmm. You don't say.
I had to get reincorporated in the bowels of hell after the April Fool's episode. It hurt. A lot. I liked it.
Alrighty. So, this is your third time taking Intro to Doom, and I'd really like it to be your last. So, this year, I'm going to try something different.
Could it not involve Doom?
Work with me here, delinquent. Today, I want to show you a megawad made entirely by people who were new to Doom mapping. I think seeing their work might inspire you.
You know what? Let's compromise. Have you ever heard of Brutal Doom?
This is going to be a long year. Hello there, I'm MountPain27, and this is Dean of Doom, the show where we give grades to classic and contemporary Doom wands. Why? Because ranking things is fun. Today's episode will be dedicated to Nova, The Birth, a 2014 megawad sprung from the mind of Michael Kildeth Kilderry. The project took flight in late 2011 and landed with the help of co-pilot Darryl, dobu, gabu, maru, Steffen roughly 3 years later. As a newcomer to the Doom community, Kildeth began the project with the intention of uniting other new mappers under a single banner, hence Nova and its subtitle, The Birth. You would think a megawad made by novices and restricted to stock Doom 2 textures would end in disaster or mediocrity at best. But mappers in their formative stages are often at their least inhibited, and that's the genius of Kildeth's idea. Their lack of adherence to conventionality is a big part of what makes Nova and its sequels so interesting. Several of its alumni have made notable careers in mapping, including, but not limited to, Cannonball, Phobus, Jaws in Space, and a guy named Cyriak Harris. Doom scholars should delight in witnessing all of these origin stories. The first Nova is undoubtedly the roughest in the series, but it blazed a trail for Novas 2 and 3, and has some genuine diamonds in the rough that I'm excited to unearth for you. Without further ado, here's how the show works. Every map gets one grade for quality and one for difficulty. Quality grades go from A to F. Grade A levels are fun, memorable, visually distinctive, creative, and a fair challenge. We grade difficulty from X to E, X for extreme, E for easy, A through D in between. Keep in mind, my idea of a great map is probably not the same as yours, but that's okay. Disagreeing is part of the fun, after all. At the end of the day, this show is about spreading the joy of Doom. So let's do so. Before we start, the rules are, we play on ultra-violence and must pistol start each level. I need to play the wand twice before reviewing it. Saves are allowed, and we go for 100% kills in all levels, making exceptions when it's just not worth it. I play on Z-Doom, and today's compatibility is limit removing. Now to the WAD. Map 1, Outpost. A simple brown bunker with more bite than you'd expect, Primeval's opener smacks you with hit scanners, and if you don't backtrack for the secret berserk, you get a mere 14 points of health to staunch your wounds. Savor these 4 shells, because that's all the boomstick ammo you get. Primeval composed this amped up MIDI himself, and it's definitely Outpost's best feature. Maybe Nova 2 and 3 spoiled me rotten, but this first impression makes me grimace a tiny bit. Grade C-, difficulty D-. Map 2, Administration Center. Whew, what a stinker. Administration Center is extremely primitive and inconsistent. A basic wheel spoke design that starts a new theme in every room and buries a quarter of its monsters in an obscure secret fight. Besides adding 2 minutes of optional gameplay and some shotgun shells to the mix, this jagged cliffside waste dump serves no purpose. On top of it all, Administration Center is one of the crudest Doom bathrooms of all time. Good god, man, are these supposed to be sinks? After playing TNT Revolution, it's surreal to see Jaws in Space's name attached to this map. Grade D-, difficulty D-. Map 3, Water Treatment Plant. Not a lot of water in this water treatment plant. There's a Mancubus wallowing in the slime room and a dead marine bleeding into this pond. Those are the only liquids I see. Mr. the Joshmon clearly spent a lot of time ripping his map apart. I doubt his insurance will cover this broken pipe, gouged floors, and smashed walls. The Chaingunner courtyard can be softened up with a secret blur artifact, and make sure you save bullets for this backstabbing baron. Grade C+, difficulty D. Map 4, Factory Factor. The most traditionally put together map in the set so far, Factory Factor is a cleanly textured, early 2000s style, industrial themed map that takes no chances. It's probably the easiest map so far, mostly because it's predictable. Shoot straight, remember to go back for the blue key once you've hit this switch, and don't fall in the slag unless you're going for the Berserk Pack. Evil Ned, which I just now realized is a pun on Evil Dead, submitted a lot of maps to Nova. He fills 4 more slots between here and map 17. Leave some for the rest of us, Ned. Grade C, difficulty D-. Map 5, Hazard Facility. Hazard Facility lives up to its name. There's absolutely no way this place was built to code. Kildeth's texturing has a ramshackle quality to it, his fight design is nothing cutting edge, and even with assistance I only found half the secrets, though you don't really need them. There's a certain novelty to playing the work of such a fresh-faced designer, but I confess I didn't really enjoy this one too much. launch. It's strange to think that the Nova series founder has only 3 credits to his name, with Hazard Facility being the only map he's completed unassisted. Grade C-, difficulty D+. Map 6, Sewage Processing. Arjak seems to grow as a mapper during sewage processing. This facade is the humblest opening view I've seen since Hell Revealed, but Arjak gets tricksy enough by the end to hide secrets within secrets, and mean enough to place monsters in a dark and poisonous crusher hallway that you won't survive without a secret radiation suit. Believe it or not, these are Nova's first revenants, which probably ties it with Doom 2 for the longest I've seen a megawad wait to introduce them. It's not that I hate Nova's first episode, but it does seem reserved for less developed newbie work. Seasoned mappers remembering their own first attempts will probably get a smile out of it. Grade D, difficulty D+. Map 7, Service Station Sick. Evil Ned's second effort is a by-the-numbers star-tan slime base with a sour ending. Don't be fooled by the innocent start. Ned's a bit of a tyrant with health and ammo allocation in this one, so use Berserk when you can, make sure to dip in the drink for a soul sphere with your one rad suit, and don't take stupid hits, because you'll be galumphing through damaging floor and taking cheap shots from chain gunners in the poison processing center. Every time you think your work in this room is done, it isn't. Ned chases this ammo-eating caco armada with 3 revenants, and wraps things up with 2 hell nobles, another bony boy, and a specter. Did I mention there's no rocket launcher or super shotgun on this map? Grade D+, difficulty C+. Map 8, Compound. A mellow mini base with a chill midi to match, Compound is the handsomest map in the set so far, showcasing Josh Mon's eye for lighting and natural scenery. This low-lit crate maze can get pretty tense without a super shotgun, which you get by invading this baron's personal space or vice versa, depending on who ends up on the floor. Again, the low body count keeps this one short, and doesn't offer much in the way of excitement once you get the double barrel. I found this Easter egg while IDDTing for the last few monsters. Wonder what it means. Grade B-, difficulty D+. Map 9, Suspend. Galvanized by some midified Finnish symphonic metal music, Suspend is an uber-linear, super shoddy palooza packed with hit scanners that mixes in heavies whenever Fuzzy Fireball feels so inclined. Fuzzy Fireball, if you're watching this, please keep creating, because your name is wonderful. Suspend debuts the arch file with an exclamation point, dropping him slap bang in the middle of a metric crap ton of chain gunners, and the 2 that appear in this reception area add a much-needed zest of danger to the proceedings. After clearing out the last room, you can get a secret plasma rifle which you probably won't have reason to fire. A gift for continuous players, I suppose. By now, Nova's warmed up and ready to rumble. Grade B, difficulty C. Map 10, Hell's Furnace. Evil Ned is back with a vengeance. Hell's Furnace is his most full-throated effort by a mile. It's a foundry map likely inspired by TNT Evolution Classics Metal and Mill. The lighting is evocative, the MIDI rocks hard, and the fights will make your super shotgun sing. Ned does throw some curveballs at uncareful players. Spectres stalk the darkness of this sweaty steel plant, and sneaky lost souls can feed you a rocket in this catwalk fight. The ending is a barn burner, lighting you up with hit scanners and bringing the hammer down when you think you're getting rewarded. Everything about Hell's Furnace improves on Ned's first 2 efforts. The energy, the ammo balance, the texture choice, and atmosphere, it's all top-notch for novice work. Grade A-, difficulty C+. Map 11, Phobus Anomaly. Not exactly a newcomer to mapping, James Phobus Cresswell had 8 years' experience under his belt when this map was released, including spots in Community Chest 3 and 4 and PRCP, which makes me wonder why the heck this map is so scatterbrained. Phobus Anomaly seems unsure of its identity, squeezing tech base, volcanic underground, and hellish abstraction into a map the size of a continental breakfast plate. The monster choice is a bit clumsy too, but in a more fun way, chucking pain elementals, revenants, mancubi, and a token baron at you willy-nilly. I suspect this is an older Phobus map, and so named because it no longer represents the kind of work he's known for. In any case, it's good for some rocket-fueled fun. Grade C+, difficulty C+. Map 12, Incubator. A bit stiff and rectangular for my liking, Incubator bears little resemblance to an apparatus by which eggs are hatched artificially. I see something that looks like a meat locker and a badly neglected arboretum, but no hatchery. Incubator's action is stilted and bad-mannered, with an excess of hit scanners and too many revenants springing out of trapdoors and dark corners. Clean and color-coordinated as this map is, I think Mr. the Josh Mon did himself a disservice by going indoors. He has a knack for nature scenes, and this rigid corporate setting doesn't seem to suit him. It's also possible that his generic choice of MIDI robbed Incubator of an identity. Armed with a creepy Lee Jackson tune, Josh Mon's Nova 2 submission turned heads. Kitchen Ace, on the other hand, hasn't saved a Doom map since 1993. Grade C, difficulty C-. Map 13, Warehouse District. Nova's slowly turning me into a Nightwish fan. Warehouse District is another classically minded map, almost certainly vanilla compatible, with a roundabout progression and some spritzes of Doom cute to tide you over between tame action sequences. It's true, Warehouse District won't challenge most players, but it won't bore them either. I dare you not to hum along to this MIDI when the refrain hits. The ambush that spills from the ground-splitting teleporters is the dramatic high point of this map. If you're scared of cyber demons, feel free to pop this invuln before facing down the map's final enemy. Simple though it is, Warehouse District feels like a love letter to old-fashioned mapping, for which the author's passion is obvious. Grade B, difficulty D+. Map 14, Man Cub Up. Ned the Nefarious strikes again with Man Cub Up, which I just now realized is a pun on... This map is grungier than a public bathroom and more full of fatsos than the Heart Attack Grill. That's a compliment, believe it or not. I had a hard time with ammo on my first go around here. I missed the SSG and didn't find the Berserk pack until it was too late. Minimize your shell expenditure on imps and pinkies because you'll need them for the Manx. Thankfully, you can avoid most of the damaging floor with careful footwork if you use up your two rad suits, but Ned makes you fight pretty hard for all the health and ammo you get, blocking your path at every turn with slabs of fire flingers. Puncture their lines of defense and you should find enough resources to domino through the rest. FYI, the red key is not needed to exit, and shooting these skulls unlocks a BFG and a teleporter to three otherwise unreachable Hell Knights. The harrowing MIDI and general stressfulness of this map make me unlikely to revisit it. Grade B-, difficulty B. Map 15, The Prisoner. Love the mapper, love the premise, not thrilled with the execution. The Prisoner makes your life a living hell at the start if you don't rush outside and grab the super shotgun right away. Take it from me, the pump action does not cut it. Doom 2 inmates run this place. The first 3 minutes are a relentless barrage of revenants, Hell Knights, chain gunners, mancubi, and arachnotrons. With the SSG and rocket launcher, you should be able to get into a groove so long as you take archvile interruptions in stride. Pressing the switches in the blue and red key quadrants will unlock the yellow key and the final fight. Say a prayer, cover your head, and run the gauntlet. Take out the flying enemies and gain the high ground while the cyber demon cleans up, the fight is essentially won. The Prisoner will have its way with less than tenacious players. It's a bit of an unfair difficulty spike, and more vindictive than other cannonball work I played. Footnote, the secret exit switch is right behind the regular one. Grade B-, difficulty A-. Map 31, Iron Exuviae. Yet another one to file under Dobu Gabu Maru maps I hated at first but now consider works of genius, Iron Exuviae is a marvel. Working without any custom textures or boom features, DGM creates a beautiful and totally unique experience that's also goddamn inscrutable and pants-wettingly difficult if you do manage to figure it out. I'm gonna slap a spoiler warning on the screen, because Iron Exuviae does lose something essential if you go into it knowing what to do. Jump to the picture timestamp now if you want to preserve the experience for yourself. I promise, it's worth it. So Iron Exuviae is a puzzle map whose regular exit can be taken without seeing a single monster. Climb into the belly of the giant metal beast, which probably gave birth to Nova 2's valedictorian, and you'll find the first of Dobu's riddles. It's essentially three brain teasers followed by a Sphinx-worthy Final Jeopardy round of torch teleportation. I strongly suggest getting out a pen and paper for this. The key is to find the decoder for this torch compass, and being something of a puzzle expert myself, it took me about 15 minutes of bumbling to notice this circuit of crushers. The decoder is at the end of it. If you match the numbers with their torch type as they orient with the compass, you can create directions to the regular exit. However, on Dean of Doom we go for 100% kills. So how do we unravel the mystery of the secret exit? Well, very perceptive players will recall that we passed one of these symbols on the way over here, and right next to it was a circular arrangement of torches similar to the compass by the teleporters. If you draw yourself a new compass and overlay the decoder, you have yourself a new set of directions, which at first appears to lead nowhere. The final twist, which even I don't think was necessary, is to check the vent over here in the corner. With the puzzle-solving portion concluded, Dobu Gabu Maru releases the hounds. There are two fights in this map. The first is a lava-soaked furnace with two archviles herding a scary amount of pinkies, imps, and hell knights. The environment works relentlessly against you, so you have to be slippery and pray for the archviles to stick their heads out. The next fight restricts your movement even further and tasks you with eliminating 32 revenants with just enough shells and rockets to do the job. At the top of the lift, an archvile and three barons await you, and this is where I imagine a lot of people throw fits and curse Dobu's name. It's very easy to run out of ammo here, and with the 16 shells up at the top of the lift, you can kill the vial, but not all three barons. I saved myself three rounds in the ring with Big Red by holding onto a few rockets and spending buckshot wisely. Iron Exuviae's singular vision, jaw-dropping visuals, razor-sharp expectations, and market intelligence make it one of the best maps I have ever played. I don't know if it's Dobu Gabumaru's best work, but in this megawad, it's a man among boys. Grade, A+. Difficulty, A+. Map 32, Riptide. Believe it, baby. This is what you fought through Iron Exuviae for. An underwater, berserkless Tyson map with almost no health or ammo in it. Playing Riptide, one thing is clear. Getsu Fune answers to nobody but Getsu Fune. In a world of Ribixes and skill saws, almost no one in their right mind today has the gumption to look at a map like this and say, yep, this is something people need to play. In two words, Riptide is fascinating garbage. It's chintzy, painful, and almost unplayable without this obscure secret. Push on the frayed end of this cord and you'll get a shotgun and a precious stim pack. Even though I can't give Riptide a good grade, in a weird way I actually really like it. It's rare to see a mapper's unfiltered view of the world. Almost as rare as having to goad cacodemons and revenants into infighting pinkies so you can shove chainsaws up their asses. The lesson here is you can easily fail to make maps that please others, so you might as well make maps that you love. Never change, Getsu Fune. Grade, D+. Difficulty, B. Map 16, Teleportarium. Teleportarium is a straightforward base blaze with some snazzy, scythe-esque lighting and mostly timid fights. You can both cut around and permanently miss sections of this map. The red skull key can be bypassed by jumping directly to the yellow card, and using the skull raises the nukage to the yellow key, but blocks off a secret pathway to some zombies and a plasma rifle. I wouldn't pass up the red key if I were you, because you'll miss the best fight in the map, this big silo room with imps and mancubi. The Teleportarium itself is a bit meek and sluggish, and you can just run away from the two art files in the exit room and rocket them. This map is mostly memorable as the companion piece to Paul D's second Nova map. Stay tuned. Grade, C+. Difficulty, C-. Map 17, Sewer City. I don't like dunking on people's magnum opuses, especially those with good intentions, but Sewer City was no fun at all for me. It's Evil Ned's largest and most ambitious work, of the same ilk as Use 3D's mega sewer map from Community Chest. First off, let me say that I have few technical complaints with Sewer City. It's a good-looking map with consistent texture use that flows together agreeably. Now, lighting-wise, that's another story. This map is so damn dark it makes the secret light amp goggles borderline necessary, and I don't know why this whole corridor has to flicker like it does. It's hard on the eyes. Missing the early super shotgun is a mistake, but I dislike how Ned directs me away from it by putting a Baron in front of the switch that opens it. Thankfully, he's kind enough to give you one for free before you take on this horrible slime room filled with revenants, arachnotrons, and ambling meat. Killing everything in here is a slow process made slower by the cycling crusher windows, and you do have to kill everything to progress, because Ned makes you teleport into each bunker to get upstairs and unlock the red key, which releases two archfiles down in the darkness. Then you have to kill everything again. While the grand unveiling at the end is impressive, the twisty staircases are unpleasant to do battle on, especially when a cyberdemon warps in to defend the blue key. Despite its obvious grasp of mapping craft, Sewer City proves slow and overbearing. Grade, C-. Difficulty, A-. Map 18, Power Core. Cannonball's rollicking, hell-bitten energy plant is an excellent rebound from Sewer City. Despite laying it on thick, Power Core feels fairer than Map 15 for the most part. With its heavy-hitting combinations, Power Core feels like an inspiration for Good Morning Phobos, though Cannonball puts more work into detailing than Sin City usually does. There's a secret BFG available early if you're good at spotting big red buttons, but you should be flush with rockets so long as you're not flushing them down the toilet. I've said this before and I'll say it again, Cannonball places an excellent archfile. They add a lot of flavor to already juicy fights and bring the map home in exciting fashion. The exit hemorrhages 8 of them, so make your green balls count. Grade, B+. Difficulty, A-. Map 19, Bad Blood. Moldy made his id Games debut in 2013 with The Eye, but Bad Blood was the first Doom map he ever made. In his own words, it was something he did to get the hang of using Doom Builder, and a good learning exercise. So he's not just a genius, he's a humble genius. From a combat perspective, Bad Blood isn't quite as nasty as Going Down, but visually it's a feast for the eyes and has significantly greater horror chops, especially at the end. This condemned cavern feeds into a blood gutter facing a huge marble skull with cacodemons pouring from its eyes, and when you muster the courage to pass through it, you'll be met with this unholy abomination of a room, steeping in bodily fluids and crawling viscera. It's a stunning sight, and I wish I'd remembered the BFG on my way in so I didn't have to backtrack sheepishly. Though Moldy's set design is beyond reproach, I didn't really enjoy playing Bad Blood. He rarely allows you to uncork the powerful weapons he hands you, and the playing field is a bit too cramped for my liking. I also miss Cyriak's insane clown music, though Nub Hat's doom-laden metal MIDI is aptly nerve-wracking by itself. grade A-, difficulty B+. Map 20, Castle Bloodletting. Nova's second episode ends on a clunker. Arjak's medieval massacre suffers from balancing issues and simplistic progression, and his secrets of a bad case of the 90s. No less than three of them are accessed by crossing line defs and running back into the previous room before a wall rises. The storage space and library are way too dark, and Arjak seems to know it. There's a light amp power-up laying on the floor right here. There's not enough health in this map, just 10 medikits and a soul sphere I didn't even find, but luckily, Castle Bloodletting's proverbial sword isn't all that sharp. The SSG, plasma rifle, and rocket launcher are available early, and you can king yourself for a BFG, which makes effortless work of these two cyber dukes. I'm really not wild about this map. It's ungainly and kind of dull. Grade D, difficulty B. Map 21, Beta Base. Move over, Gene Bird. There's a new sheriff in town. I won't mince words, folks. Beta Base is a garbage bag full of excrement set alight on the front porch of this Megawad's last episode. I have no clue why this map was accepted. Even next to other beginner work, Beta Base does not look good. It's as if Joe Ilya drew this map while operating a jackhammer. It's a mishmash of crooked, constricted rooms with no semblance of continuity or even intentional discontinuity between them. Even if you're choosing to interpret Joe Ilya's abysmal texturing as hellish corruption, this map is just... I mean, do I even have to say anything? I'm pretty sure these images speak for themselves. The most priceless detail on the map is this drain on the floor. Like, you went through all the effort to draw a grate, but you didn't take the time to space it evenly or cover up the bar parts? Seriously, what are you doing? Beta Base plays as hideously as it looks. Not many monsters can fit in any given room, so the action is literally as mundane as it gets. I feel bad that Hell Revealed 2 has to be associated with this map by way of its MIDI. That's how bad Beta Base is. I've played much more painful maps, but this is far enough away the least competent Doom level I have ever seen. Grade F. Difficulty C+. Map 22, Broken Confluence Point. In the Doomwad reviewing business, sometimes you just get tired of playing the same old map, and you gain an appreciation for oddballs like this one. Broken Confluence Point is aggressively eccentric, but compensates for its rough edges with creativity and verve. You start in some kind of silver server farm with cords running every which way, but flip this switch and... Uh-oh. Looks like you blew a giant hole in the wall. The silver building continues on the other side of the Hell Cavern, decorated with couches and big remote controls this time. Fight through pain elementals, spiders, and an archfile to get the red key, which unlocks a second detonator, and this is where the map gets really crazy. The second explosion rips a hole big enough for a cyber demon and a small army to fit through. You have no hope of winning this fight without infighting and a lot more ammo. Turns out you're in luck. Sort of. Getsu Fune pops open two semi-secret ammo cabinets here and at the start, but don't expect to get them for free. This fight is freeform mayhem, and I actually really dig it. Fry the cyber, and it's smooth sailing to the exit, which has one more quirk to show off. If you don't follow the candle path closely, you'll teleport to a room full of barrels, which will blow you into the next map with single-digit health. Getsu Fune, you just earned yourself a new fan. Grade B+, difficulty B+. Map 23, Immaterium. This looks familiar. Maybe it's for the best that Paul D's teleportarium didn't make a huge impression, because by the time it dawns on you that you've seen this place before, it collapses before your eyes. Bottom dropping out of this lobby is a spectacular moment, and it gets even better from there. As you flee through a network of fleshy horrors and hellish perversions connected by teleporters, a real sense of discomfort begins to sink in, which builds to outright anxiety when you return to the bloody void pit with the yellow key. Pressing the skull switch triggers an ambush that can easily throttle an uncareful ammo spender. With how hard it is to balance finding cover and staying off the damaging blood, the archfiles that show up here are one of the scariest parts of the map. Immaterium could use a bit more health and ammo, even counting the hard-to-find secret soul sphere, but otherwise it's an outstanding map. Tense, twisted, and terrifying. Grade A-, difficulty B+. Map 24, Ring of Gyges. This heavy metal sandbox barks louder than it bites. Ring of Gyges will surely intimidate newcomers with its thronging armies and epic scale, but if we check the stats, 90% of its 471 enemies are imps, pinkies, cacos, or hell knights, fodder for your rocket launcher. Don't get stampeded, and you're unlikely to die. Ring of Gyges sports some neat Greek architecture, and I like digging up its secrets, most of which require a bit of climbing. The optional yellow keycard in the crags unlocks the BFG, which is guarded by the only two archfiles on the map. After the ruckus dies down, Gyges becomes a drag for 100% killseekers. It's almost like Stygian is training for the Monster Window Dressing Olympics. These imps and hell knights tucked up high on the cliffsides are just the worst. I almost feel bad picking them off. It's not like they were hurting anybody. I can't help but feel this map's name was mostly chosen because it sounded cool after I learned from a quick Google search that the Ring of Gyges is actually a platonic hypothetical about whether good people could keep from doing bad things if they had a ring of invisibility. I mean, It does sound cool. Grade B, difficulty B. Map 25, Vile Arterium, a decadent slice of hell. Vile Arterium was originally made by Death Egg, heavily reworked by Cyriak, and Dobu Gabu Marufied combat-wise. Aesthetically, it's Cyriak through and through, jammed with malevolent machinery and bleeding from every orifice. Vile Arterium sort of reminds me of a racetrack. It's constructed in lanes that funnel you into a final room, but its corridors, alleyways, and blood-soaked sewers make a circuit all the way around as well. Moldy and DGM pump you full of plasma, so don't be afraid to use it. Vile Arterium goes heavy on Revenants, Mancubi, and Barons of Hell, which will trap hammer-headed or capricious players between rocks and hard places. This map smacked me around on first playthrough, but with a patient approach, Vile Arterium can be poked and prodded from all sides until its defenses collapse. As usual, I'm floored by Cyriak's Command of Doom 2 textures. He brings freshness to a tired, old Hell map tradition. Grade A-, difficulty A-. Map 26, Hell's Playground. I'm not exaggerating when I say Joe Ilya's two Nova submissions could teach an entire seminar on how not to make a Doom map. Marginally better than Beta Base, only because there's more ammo and room to move, Hell's Playground is still a half-baked aberration that no amount of back to the drawing board could have salvaged. It's hideous, colorblind texturing, non-existent lighting, and askew architecture make it hard to even look at, and it's full of odd thingamabobs like this voodoo doll, this weird damaging button under a column you have to bump your head on, and numerous fake walls which hide Mancubi and the occasional secret. The map ends on the most doppic cyberdemon fight I've ever seen. You have to jump in his playpen and twiddle your thumbs until an off-screen Romero's head gets crushed to finish the map. Footnote, anybody who can see the resemblance between this map and Whispers of Satan or Super Mario would not pass a drug test. Grade F. Difficulty C+. Map 27, Sensorium. The wheel of weird never stops in Nova the Birth. Kildeth's second last offering to his brainchild project is disjointed but occasionally striking, a crumbling subterranean hell fortress that makes some brave texture choices. There are only 80 monsters in this map, and they don't stand a chance if you find even a few secrets. You can get an early rocket launcher and a megasphere by walking along this railing and through a fake wall, recharge with a pair of soul spheres, and most importantly, take this teleporter to reach the BFG, which you can polish off the cyberdemon with. I'm not really sure what happened here, but the blue door opened all by itself in this recording. I guess, under the right conditions, even the mandatory stuff in this map is optional. Sensorium is upbeat, but also clunky, liable to discombobulate the player, and a bit too easy. Grade C, difficulty B-. Map 28, The Seventh Circle. Oh boy. Send a prayer up to the deity of your choice. Moldy has entered his final form. Fun fact, the Seventh Circle of Hell is where those who commit violent sins in life are tortured for eternity. The Seventh Circle was a discarded primeval map that the Clown Prince of Chaos refurbished. Cyriak describes it as an orgy of destruction. The first minutes are some of the most frantic in the Megawad. You have no hope of turning the infernal tide, so duck into the library where you can hold out in siege. There's a funny looking face in the wall in here, which if you shoot it will unlock an optional fight and a red skull key that comes in handy later. Ride the super shotgun to a plasma rifle, hit the skull with sunglasses, and get ready for a superheated shootout with a steady stream of mid-tiers, including pain elementals and archviles, who are a huge source of stress with all the corpses lying around. From the library, you'll have to flee into a cracked cavern bonanza. With a rocket launcher and some aggressive positioning, you can light up the revenants and their archvile handlers, but there's a more elegant solution. There are two silver switches which lower cyberdemons into the middle of the revenant mobs. When the cybers win their infights, follow this tunnel to a now exposed teleporter, vaporize the cybers, and get a critical blue key. It's a peachy deal, but hard to find, or in my case, remember to find. If you don't unlock the BFG, the final fight will knock your teeth into next week. I never expected a coddling from Cyriak, but the Seventh Circle is harder than most of Going Down, and much longer than those maps. It's a powerful, frightening level that will etch its name in your brain with a smile. Grade A, difficulty X-. Map 29, Extorta Nova. Taking a calm before the storm approach with Nova's penultimate slot, the crumbling ruin of Extorta Nova has one of the lowest monster counts in the Megawad, but don't write it off yet. Hitting a pair of Satyr switches unlocks a garden of lion blocks that serves as the scene of the final fight. Watch out for cyber rockets on your way to the switches, and keep off the yellow cracks. They're hot. The garden is protected by a pair of wandering cyberdemons, and you'll get ambushed by two archviles and another cyberdemon when you go for the BFG. The invuln behind cyber number 3 is the key to defusing this fight. Extorta Nova plays like a vignette from a larger map, but its surreal aesthetic and quiet MIDI do a fine job building anticipation for the finale. Grade B-, difficulty B+. Map 30, Megiddo. probably the single most imposing level in the Nova series, Megiddo is synonymous with Armageddon and puts the powers of Hell on full display. It was Dobu Gabu Maru's idea to cap things off with an ensemble piece composed of a central hub and portals leading to fragments made by different mappers. The concept made its way into the next two Novas, infiltrated the French projects Troisieme Diagonie 3 and 180 MPV, and remains one of the most innovative and daunting ways to end a megawad. The portals can be taken in any order, and you're allowed to skip two of them if you find the experience too overwhelming. From weakest to strongest, here are Megiddo's five challenges. Part 1, Arjak. I don't recommend first-timers leading off with this one because it's definitely Megiddo's weakest link, essentially just a huge, under-detailed red cave that can be BFG'd into oblivion and harvested for supplies. Part 2, Kildeth. In the same vein as his map 27, Kildeth's segment is a haphazardly sketched and sparsely populated hellish underground that's ultimately exploitable. If you take the backside of his teleport gate, you'll save yourself a lot of irritation, giving yourself backdoor access to the upper deck where a megasphere, invuln, and a lot of cells are there for the taking. With the god orb, you can mow down two irritating archfiles and three cyberdemons down in the water, rendering the rest of the segment essentially toothless. Swim upstream like a lava salmon, climb the pipe pyramid, and move on. Part 3, Moldy. The blue is what really grabs me here. Cyriak's dystopic segment recalls Speed of Doom's binary title map. I'd rate this one higher if it wasn't so vicious. Moldy himself calls it a bit of a bastard. If you don't attack this portal first, it's not quite as nasty, but the onslaught of Arachnos, Hell Knights, Mancubi, and Archfiles bringing them all back is pretty overwhelming, especially with it being so hard to safely generate offense. All in all, it's one of the best decorated segments, and the harshness fits Moldy's ice-cold visuals. Part 4, Cannonball. A slaughter fest of scythe-like proportions, and definitely the hardest part of Megiddo for me, Cannonball's segment starts off in a bloody metal arena and spills into an absolute bombardment in the Valley of Hell. Besides patience, infighting, and a hawk eye for stray cyber missiles, the only thing that will help you here is foreknowledge of archfile triggers. Good luck, Marine. Part 5, Dobu Gabu Maru. Megiddo's longest and most complex segment by a long shot comes courtesy of its mastermind. Dobu's offering is simply astonishing. A microcosm of Nova itself. It's a corrupted, fragmented collage of every mapper's work. DGM buries his own work in a nested secret, bringing back the furnace fight for a searing encore. Ironically, with a full BFG, it's not as bad as the original. Once you've toppled all five of Megiddo's torture rooms, unlock the gate, take what you need from the floating altar, and prepare for the final test. Clear this platform of monsters, waste three cyber demons, and pepper the ugly eyeball with rockets to wake up from this nightmare. Megiddo is one of the greatest map 30s of all time. A stirring, stunning and devastating piece of work that drops the mic on its megawad with a deafening, unforgettable thud. Grade A+, difficulty X-. So, what did you think, Delinquent? Anything here strike your fancy? Delinquent?
Huh? Mika Slow.
Do you really want to take my class again?
Actually, I'm starting to wonder what's going on here. I'm the only student in your class, and this is the only class going on in the whole school. It's kind of creepy, to be honest.
Look at the time. I guess it's time for you to scurry on home, delinquent. Class dismissed. Nova the Birth is, above all, a coming-of-age story. Its preteen maps aren't fully developed, its early adult maps show signs of promise but also fail miserably at times, but by the time it reaches 30, Nova seems to have figured itself out. Nova 1 is my least favorite entry in the series by several lengths, but I'm proud of these lads and lass nonetheless, and Kildeth and Dobu deserve pats on the back for keeping the Doom vs. door open to new creators. Noble as that mission is, the end product was never destined for greatness. My final grade for Nova the Birth is a C+. Nova's difficulty curve could make a person seasick just to look at, but I'll settle on a B-. On average, it's easier than the modern standard, but it's got some wild surprises in store. Now for my Dean's List. Valedictorian, Map 31, Iron Exuviae. Salutatorian, Map 30, Megiddo. Class President, Map 28, The Seventh Circle. And the dunce cap goes to Map 21, Beta Base. Nova also qualifies for a short honor roll, including the following. Map 10, Hell's Furnace. Map 19, Bad Blood. Map 23, Immaterium. Map 25, Vile Arterium. And Map 28, The Seventh Circle. Thank you very much for watching, and please feel free to share your thoughts on the WAD down below. I'd love to hear what you think, and I'll heart your comments to let you know I've read them. Now I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge my generous patrons. Aaron Allen, Agile Jackson, Agu XYZ, Alec Wehrman, Alephany, Alex Max, Alex Topfer, Artisan Talzar, Bo Higginbotham, Beatbeard, Ben Barrett, Birdburn, Blind as a Mat, Builder Sith, Bitefire, Kappa Bitch, Collie Bluefin, Cheesewheel, Chris Duthat, Chris O'Neill, Christopher Hart, Christophine Place, Cutman Mike, Dan, Dario Romero, Dave Davidson, Delirium, Doot Yourself, Dorothy Miller, Egg Boy, Ember, Emil Jan, Emma Essex, Endless Moose, Faithful, Felix Wilson, Francis T218, General Roasterock, Glenn Marmon, Goody, Griffin Upchurch, Hyakshō, In Captivity, Jeff Hibbert, Jeff Shirilla, Jose Ballestero, Josh Ballard, Jude, Just Some Schmuck, Just Great 98, Camille Bernadotte, Killplane, Quan, Leon Staten, Logan Lazalba, Lumnal, Mark Rowland, MasterDrew 117, Matt, Matthew Gower, Matty Light 1990, Meta 47, Michael Akins, Miracle Water, Mixer, MK 2021, Moko Mothman MM47, Mozicon, Myolden, Nafferty, Neurometry, Knights 108, Number 26, NX Avery, Omnibot, Painful Hill 72, Pezavang Zhaj, Philip Coffey, Pixel Perfect PT, Pyro Shi, Quibs, Randy A, Red Doomed Earth, Reese, Reese Anderson, Richard Fry, Roadworks, Rune, Sean Doherty, Sega Monkey, Sid Menon, Small Venom, Snacker Fork, Some Spoony Bard, Space Clanka, Spinner 8, Stonemason, Stupid Nick, Sunriser, Sylvester Priss, Tara Cuscino, That Guy Known as Will, The Cloptologist, The Fiery Charmeleon, The Dinosaur Heretic, The Freeman 500, TJG1289, Trilby Trillion, Turbine 2K5, Ultra Cow, Why Bemo Not a Crab, William Huber, and Wonka Shack. Thank you. I appreciate you all very much. This is Mount Pain 27, and I'll see you in the next episode of Dean of Doom.